I work for Ericsson, and the product I'm dealing with is voucher server. I'm the chief architect for the voucher server, and the session we are going to discuss is migration from Thrift to SQL. Okay, so we see this thing. This reminds you of something a few years back. Matrix. Isn't it? Now, you must be wondering that first screen I'm showing to be continued. Well, the only thing is that when I think of this topic, there's one thing which comes to my mind, and that is this statement from Matrix, the last sentence which Neo says when he flies. I didn't come here to tell you how this is going to end. I came here to tell you how it's going to begin. Well, it may sound a little disconnected at the moment, but you'll see the connection later. And what we are going to discuss is these sections, like why Thrift to SQL, and impact of data model, impact on the data model of this movement from Thrift to SQL, and what are the approaches we have for this, and the comparison of these approaches from different dimensions, and followed by the summary. Okay, so setting the context of the discussion. When everyone thought there is no alternative to RDBMS, one started his journey with Cassandra. And he interfaced the application with the Cassandra using Thrift interface, which was the only interface at that time. But 5 years down the line, Thrift is deprecated, and SQL is the new interface. Well, if you are the person who moves into the technology early, later you have to face some challenges when the technology improves, and that's why you need to deal with now Thrift and SQL. SQL interface was introduced in Cassandra in November 2012. Since then, Cassandra can be interfaced using Thrift as well as SQL interface. So as you see in this picture here, you have Cassandra, which has a Thrift interface, which has a SQL interface, and your application need to use an appropriate client in order to interface with the respective interface with its respective protocol. Okay, both are there, perfectly fine. But what happens is that development of Thrift interface has been officially frozen from last 2 years, and Thrift support will be completely removed in Cassandra 4.0. Okay, that means moving from Thrift to SQL is not just a choice. It is mandatory in order to leverage new capabilities of Cassandra, and if you want your application to be ready for Cassandra 4.0. Okay, there are a few more things, like with Cassandra 3.0 onwards, performance of SQL is much better than that of Thrift. So if you want to leverage that, you have to move from Thrift. And SQL is easier to use because it's similar to SQL, which everybody is quite comfortable with. So there are sufficient drivers. But okay, there are a few things you have to think about when you think of this transition. Moving, so all the touch points of your application are going to change. They will get affected. Now it depends how decoupled your touch points were. So based on the design you have, you may have to rework on some of the your frameworks which provide you things like atomicity, isolation. This is not a mandatory list. Depends on your design, that how decoupled it is. But if it is not, then these frameworks you will have to rework on. Okay. Now, when we have set the context, let's discuss what is the impact on the data model which is going to happen. And this is the primary thing which makes it a non-trivial topic. Otherwise, sounds pretty trivial that you move from one library to another. So unlike Thrift, SQL depends more on column metadata. And this means if your table has both fixed and dynamic columns, then SQL will be able to read only fixed columns. So here, little convention things are there, like what you call static column in Thrift and what you call static column in SQL are different. That's why I'm trying to stay away from that confusion. So I'm not using the word static column, rather I'm saying fixed column, which are part of your schema. And those which are not part of your schema, they are the dynamic ones. So if your table has both, you have a problem when you move to SQL. Okay, let's see with an example. When I was putting together these slides, I was looking for a hotel in this vicinity, and that's why this came to my mind, and I put together an example with just some hotel database. So here you have a row key, which is a unique ID for a hotel. You have name of the hotel, city of the hotel, state, zip, and phone. You have this table, and when you look at what is the corresponding schema you put in, say typically Cassandra CLI, it is like this, column family, hotels, and then you put give the details of the column metadata, which has all these column names listed, name, city, state, zip, and phone. Here you might have noticed that in the heading I write Cassandra table, whereas in this statement I'm saying create column family hotels. So this is again a convention thing. What you referred up to the Thrift as column family is now referred as Cassandra table when you use move to SQL. It's just a nomenclature thing. Okay, so this is our example, and what you see in the table over here is a logical view. And how Cassandra stores it is more similar to this thing, where you have one row which has the name of the column, value of the column, followed by the timestamp, and then the next column, its value, timestamp, and these are grouped by the row key. And for every hotel, you have this bunch of things. So just to keep this in mind that when Cassandra is storing it, relates more like this rather than that two-dimensional thing which we saw. Okay, now what happens when a dynamic column comes? So as you can see that here, I have added another column called my rating. I've stayed in this hotel and I say it's just average. That's my rating of the thing, and this was never part of the schema. My application was giving me this capability, I did it. I added it to them. So now, this is an example where the schema, the metadata doesn't have my rating, but actually the database has it. Now, what will happen is that SQL won't be able to read this dynamic column when you read this data, and because it is not in the metadata. So that is the problem, and that's why data model is getting affected because of this problem. And now we will take a look at approaches which we can take to deal with this problem. So there are two approaches. First is that add collections to the schema. Second is make the table schema-less. And again, I reiterate, this you have to do only if you have dynamic as well as fixed columns in your table. Otherwise, it's straightforward. Okay, let's take the case of adding collections to the schema. So here, what we do is that we replace the multiple dynamic columns with one or more collections, for example, map. So here, if you see, I've taken an example here where for one hotel, I have this dynamic column called my rating, where I say it's just average. And for the second hotel, I have my rating, which I say above average, but I have a portal rating also available. And that says good. So what I do here is that in the schema, I add a collection called rating. And for the first record, what I do is that I say I have just my rating, so I say my rating, that's just average. And in the second one, I say rating, my rating, above average, and portal rating, good. So that's the first approach where I am adding additional fixed column in my schema to deal with this dynamic behavior, which I want in my application. Second approach, make the table schema-less. So what I do is that drop the entire column metadata. So here you see that I run this command, update column family hotels, and saying that column metadata is blank, just the square brackets. So now what happens is that it becomes possible for SQL to traverse all these, my rating here. I don't have to change anything in my data model here. And the reason is that now all the columns are dynamic column. So what happens is that Cassandra falls back on a mechanism where it has an internal columns, which is called column one and value. So column one has the listing of all the column names, and value has the listing of all the values of those columns. So the whole thing is transposed. It is more like the way it is representing data. That's how it will be. And these are the internal things, column one and value. It's not user defined. These are not programmer defined. So once you make it schema-less, it becomes traversable. And that's the second approach, which we discussed. So first one is you have to change the model. Second one, you have to do away with the metadata completely. Okay, just a few words about schema-less table. We have an advantage here, which I want to highlight. What is this advantage? So usually applications perform multiple operations on a table, and these operations can be like adding new data records, going for a particular row key and updating the data corresponding to that record, and updating data records in bulk based on certain criteria. And one can be just reading the entire thing and making the report. I'm just taking some examples of various functions you may have in your program, in your application. So good news here is, which I refer as advantage, is that API that work with Thrift interface will continue working even without the metadata. So as we discussed in the previous slide, with the schema-less approach, we have removed the metadata, all the contents of metadata. But Thrift interface APIs, they will continue working with it as if nothing has happened. You don't have to change your code at all to keep the old implementation working. So this gives you a flexibility that all these functions, you can move one by one. Just an illustration for this is that these are four functions. They are all, so say for Thrift, you're using Hector APIs, and they are connecting with Thrift interface of the Cassandra. So everybody is talking, and SQL interface nobody is using. Now you can have the next release where you move only one function to SQL, and everything else is still using Thrift. And one by one, you move all of them. So in four releases, you can do it at a regular pace. You don't have this constraint that everything has to be migrated in one go. Because if you're dealing with an application which is pretty huge, all the things in a single sprint may not be possible. So this is a very good thing, but it is possible only with schema-less, leveraging the fact that making it schema-less is not going to affect your Thrift APIs. Okay, so we have seen the two approaches. Now what we will discuss is that comparison of these two approaches. And, well, there are multiple criterias Let's start with the basic things which we have seen in the previous slide, just a tabular representation of that. So first one is schema with collection and schema-less. In schema with collection, you have regular data, it requires data migration because your schema definition has changed. You have added another column over there. Whereas in schema-less, no data migration is required. You just run one command and do away with that metadata, and you are just perfect. So it saves a lot of effort. And next is, as we discussed in this illustration, that with schema with collection, you have to move completely in one go, whereas here, you can move functionalities one by one. Okay, just wait. Don't jump for schema-less, because there's one more important parameter we have to compare, that is performance. How all this which we are doing in these two things is going to affect the performance. Though, as we can see that so far, whatever we have seen, schema-less seems to be winning in this race. But performance is something we have to look into. So let's see. So here are some of the results of the observations from the prototyping which we did. And here, the Cassandra version was 2014. And what we did is that we had a data size of 1 million record for this sample. And first, we considered two kind of operations. One are key-based queries, where we have the row key, and we do the query based on that. And second was write operations. And the three bars you see is that, first is that before all anything related with SQL was done in the thing, the existing performance. And once we did the migration using schema with collection, that's your middle, this brown color bar. And the last one is the schema-less. So as we have seen, as we see that time taken for these operations is coming down, and trend is quite consistent. But variation is not much. In the first one, key-based read queries, here you have hardly difference of 4% to 5% improvement. And in write operation, you have some improvement of roughly 10 to 18%. 10% in case of schema with collection, and roughly 18% with schema-less. So okay, so far you can say a marginal improvement in performance, and schema-less seems to be winning so far. Another scenario we take, So another scenario we take is the full table scan, like the report generation thing, which scenario we had discussed. So here we have to do the full table scan of the complete table, and here we have taken data set of 50 million records. And as you can see, here a trend has changed a lot. Here we have good amount of variation between the two approaches. Whereas schema-less is giving almost the same performance, but schema with collection, that the performance has dropped significantly, almost by, it is double. Like from 9.5, it becomes 21 minutes for the full table scan of 50 million records. So, well, this is just a summarization of what we discussed. So, well, this thing when we discuss, this is where I say anybody who has done any amount of web research on this topic will be disappointed. Because when you Google on this topic, the first page you get is this. And it talks about much bigger figures, 50%, 160%. And what you're getting here? 5%, 15%, and here, forget about improvement, there is a drop in performance in one of the approaches. So that's what I say, the first slide which we see. That, here, it's something has to happen. It's a sequel has to come to reach to your conclusion. This is if you stay. So when you move from SQL to Thrift, you are on, and you are on Cassandra 2.0, the performance benefit is not going to be significant. So your journey is going to be two-step. And that's why, as said, related with a movie which has a sequel, so that you saw the complete movie and still you didn't reach your conclusion. You did this elaborate activity of changing your data points with the application, et cetera, and you didn't get what you thought that you'll be getting in the performance. And here, the performance benefit will come when you upgrade your Cassandra, not if you stay on 2.0x version. And well, we have some interesting data over here, and trust me, when I saw this data for the first time, this is something crazy. Scenario here, as in the previous scenario, we have seen that the data here in the full table scan, we have some crazy behavior, whereas other two are still quite consistent. So we take a look, detailed look of on this particular scenario, full table scan of 50 million record, and we use Spark version 1.2 to carry out it using distributed computing. And what you see over here is that in 2014, the performance is 9.7. This blue line which you see is that is a reference, which is before you did anything related with SQL. And when you migrate to 2013, the performance even for the schema-less is going down significantly. So as you can see that, it has gone to 19, almost double. And when you go to 2.2.5, then it improves marginally, but looks like nothing is improving much here. And when you go to 3.0.4, it's again improving, but again marginally. You're not even touching the blue line again, even till 3.0. So, okay. Here, what we see is that 2014 schema-less gives same performance, and performance is pretty bad when you go into higher releases. So what you saw, the data so far, that 2.0 schema-less was winning so far, but schema, the moment you do the upgrade, it's giving very bad results. And schema with collection. Here, again, an interesting pattern. Almost reverse of what we see in schema-less. Here, if you are on 2014, as we saw in the previous graph, your time taken increases significantly, almost double. But with every upgrade, it is coming down. And when you reach 3.0, it's almost half of the what you had before any of the migration. So this gives you almost a different picture that when you're going for Cassandra upgrade, then this strategy is far, far better than schema-less as far as performance is concerned. And, well, so with this, we are almost towards the end, and we just summarize the whole thing, saying that moving from Thrift to SQL is important for the lifecycle management solution of the solution, because 4.0 will not support Thrift anymore. And SQL gives a challenge when both, as we discussed, that the problem is only when fixed and dynamic columns both are present. And then we have two approaches, and performance of SQL improves with Cassandra version upgrade and becomes significantly high after upgrade to Cassandra 3.0. Well, with this, we come to an end. Any questions?
So when you had the slide where you had to clear the metadata, just by emptying it out. Would it been an option to redefine the metadata with the new dynamic field that you just put in?
This is the one, yeah.
Yeah. So is does that that update allow you to actually define the metadata again to, with the new dynamic field that you just put in?
No, here we have removed the metadata, so now there is no column information in the metadata.
I know, but you did that so that it could make the column one, but I meant that could you have redefined the column metadata in, to include that new dynamic field? Could you have defined the metadata at that time? I mean, in this...
That can be done,
okay,
but not in all cases, because in some cases, the name of the dynamic field is not consistent. For example, in our case, what we had is that we used to postfix a timestamp in the column name, and that was the requirement of the kind of logic we had. So name is not same all the time. In some of the cases, then it won't be possible. Otherwise, it was it is possible.
So how did you handle the case of the data migration to get the data from your existing schema into this new collection model? What approach did you use to handle that?
That's not an easy task. It's like you have to take all data out and put it over there. One of the best preferred way to do it, use a Spark-based utility running on a separate machine to carry out that job for you.
So you do it. You did it as ETL then. You basically did full table scan, grabbed all the records, and then wrote them back out?
Well, if I'd say that what we have been doing, we are in the middle of this thing because there is one more constraint here that from 2.0 to 3.0, you can't upgrade directly. That
right.
upgrade of data migration is Cassandra level change is not supported. So when you are moving from 2.0 to 3.0, you have to stop over 2.1 mandatorily. So it has to be two-way thing. So what we have done, as since it's our product and performance drop in the product because of any change is something which can never be, is never be possible. So here you see that if you look at this data, there are only 2 points across these two tables. There are only two points which are on or below the reference line. That means if I'm rolling out a new version of the product in the market, then either I have to be with schema-less approach on the 2.0 itself, or I will have to go to 3.0 with schema with collection. So of course, since I cannot jump from 2.0 to 3.0 directly, we have to take a two-step process that first we go to the schema-less, which is anyway very easy, no data migration required, and stick to the 2.0. And once that is done, then we migrate, we upgrade our Cassandra version to 2.1, and then we upgrade to 3.0, where we do the data migration of because we are changing our table schema.
Okay.
So it's, you can say, three-step process to reach this the best this performance of 4.4 from where you are before this SQL migration.
So the approach we're attempting to do is we have a 2.0 instance running SQL, and we're going to attempt to do ETL to load directly into a 3.0 separate cluster and do that all in one step so we don't have to go through all these iterative upgrades and then try to handle all of these changes along the way.
That can be done, but that is going to take a lot of time, and sometimes it is not possible to do it within the maintenance window of a product. And that's the problem.
One second. Did you have a question?
I know this talk is directed at this particular issue. Do you have any experience, anecdotal, with just straightforward moving from Thrift to CQL in, you know, using the Java driver in a way that seems to directly, you know, correlate, but any performance issues? So any unexpected performance issues moving, say, from Hector to the Java driver with,
there are no performance issues, but so when you do it, it all depends. See, another thing is that I have taken here, as you can see, the worst case scenario, which is full table scan, which is not a very usual requirement with Cassandra solutions. But well, in our case, we had a reporting feature, so we had this. But if you don't have this full table scan thing, then your life is much, much easier. Because then what you're dealing with is this. And here you can see that though you are not getting that 160% or 70% improvement, but improvement is there. So you can do the migration to a SQL taking any of the approach, and you can be happy that there will not be any performance drop. But the only tricky part comes when you need full table scan. That makes the problem a bit non-trivial and lengthy, you can say, to solve.
We got time for one more question, if anybody has one.
I would just like to comment one thing, that there is a Jira, ongoing Jira.
There is an ongoing Jira on this Thrift to SQL migration. So it is 10.103.10.857, right? So this Jira allows you to drop compact storage, which is the Thrift format of doing things. So maybe instead of writing your own utility based on Spark to do migration and do the painful part, maybe when this Jira is resolved, you will be easily able to just run one command and then migrate from Thrift format to the latest format without any custom data migration utility. So that is still in progress, unresolved mark right now, but work is happening on that. So that would make your job much easier.
All right, thank you.
Okay, thanks.